As I come out of Lakeville, I spotted it.
Well, it sounded more or less like a locomotive coming over.
It took the car up in the air, and it twirled around, and it went across the highway.
There were practically hundreds of homes that were just completely leveled.
It felt like something was drawing the breath right out of my body.
And I was awful lucky to get out.
On Palm Sunday, 1965, death whirled from the sky and left 81 dead. Now, News 22 remembers the Palm Sunday tornadoes, Michiana's worst disaster.
The first band of the killer tornado slashed across the five-county northern Indiana area shortly before nightfall, as we mentioned earlier. The second cluster swirled out of the sky an hour later and ripped across central Indiana. At last count, as we have it from around the state, 91 persons were killed in the state of Indiana by the twisters which hit the state earlier tonight.
That was the WSBT News Special Report, just one of many broadcasts on April 11th, 1965, the day the Palm Sunday tornadoes ripped apart our homes, our neighborhoods, and our lives. Good evening. I'm meteorologist Sam Scammon. Today is the 30-year anniversary of Michiana's worst disaster. On April 11th, 1965, the skies opened up with fury, unleashing violent thunderstorms and killer tornadoes. More area residents lost their lives in this tragedy than from any other disaster in our history. Tonight, we take an in-depth look back at the storm. We'll hear stories from those who lost family and friends, and we'll also look ahead. What did we learn? How have we changed? And how can we better prepare ourselves if and when tragedy strikes again? There are, of course, many stories from the days following the Palm Sunday tornadoes, like the six-year-old boy who frantically ran to get help for his family who was trapped in the rubble of their home, or the doctor at Goshen Hospital who worked through the night treating hundreds of injured people, or the woman who desperately braced herself in the oncoming funnel, but moments later found herself in the middle of a nearby lake. They all have different perspective, but they share a common bond. They survived when over 250 perished. Among those, 81 died here in northern Indiana. Mother Nature's wrath came on fast and furious, and unfortunately, the day's unusual weather was interpreted more as a natural oddity than as a final warning. But looking back, many survivors now talk about the ominous feel in the air that day.
It was unseasonably warm in the morning, and in fact, it was uncommon for us to be out doing things like playing baseball and softball and those sorts of things that early in the year.
Palm Sunday of 1965 was a unusually warm day.
It was a very humid day. It was very close, warm, exceptionally close for that time of the day or year.
And they were right. It was a sultry Palm Sunday. Bendix Field recorded a high temperature of 73 degrees with 91 hundredths of an inch of rain. But the record books indicate only a fraction of what actually happened that day. The meteorology was impressive. A powerful cold front was in the process of pushing through the Midwest. Warm, unstable air was feeding up from the south. And a strong jet stream moved from the southern plains into the Great Lakes. All of the atmospheric dynamics were rapidly coming together, which later that day would produce Michiana's worst disaster. Tornadoes form from strong thunderstorms. The clashing of air masses provide the forcing of air upward. Violent thunderstorm cells called mesocyclones develop. These are storms that have circulation. Tornadoes originate in the mid-levels of the storm and spin down to the ground. While on the ground, they can destroy anything in their paths. The U.S. Weather Bureau had issued a number of special weather bulletins highlighting the potential for bad storms. At 12:20 p.m., a severe thunderstorm and tornado forecast was issued for portions of the region. At 5:30, a revised severe storms forecast was issued, which included all of Michiana. The first funnel was reported 18 minutes later, north-northeast of Knox, shortly before touching down. Over the next 93 minutes, a squall line of strong thunderstorms would produce six violent tornadoes, most moving simultaneously from the west-southwest to the east-northeast, leveling everything in their paths. But the tornadoes were not confined only to our area. Across the Midwest, this powerhouse storm produced 51 tornadoes, taking 256 lives, injuring thousands, and destroying $200 plus millions of dollars worth of property. This outbreak ranks as the third largest in United States history. Despite the loss of life and property elsewhere, northern Indiana was hit worst. The devastation was so bad that the President of the United States, Lyndon Johnson, made a special trip to Michiana to see the damage. WSBD was at Bendix Field and interviewed the President after he got off the plane.
Mr. President, may we have a few words? May we have a few words for live television, Mr. President? Can you give us your impressions of what you saw in Elkhart County today, sir? Pardon me, sir, that's the end of our mic line. Can we have just a few words, please?
Well, it's very sad, and very sorry that all this tragedy has been visited upon these wonderful people in this good state.
Is it worse?
We're sorry what's happened, and we want to do anything we can to be helpful.
Does this indicate federal aid will be coming, sir? It does. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
The first lives to be lost were south of South Bend, where the tornadoes originally developed. That's just where the Clark family lived. 12 family members were at the farmhouse that day, celebrating Palm Sunday together. But just as dinner time approached, so did some frightening weather. Without any time to spare, the Clark family rushed to the basement. 6-year-old Ricky Clark had never seen anything like this before in his short life. But 30 years later, he says it's something that he'll never forget.
I can remember him running around, closing doors. Outside, closing doors to the barn. And it just got worse. And it got dark. And I remember everybody hollering, get to the basement. And next thing I know, there's stuff laying all over. And everybody's hollered. And I said I could get out. And I heard one person tell me to stay put. And then I heard somebody else tell me to go. And I think Dad's the one that told me to go. I could. And I just went out and started heading down the lane to the people, to whoever I could find. And neighbors picked me up coming up the lane. And at that time, I didn't know who was hurt, who wasn't. Just knew I was getting out.
It took everything. And you wouldn't have believed that anyone could have come out of that house alive. Because there was 12 people in the house altogether, and four of them were killed. So the other eight were, in a lot of ways, it was a lot of miracles that happened to save them.
My brother died in it, and that was a lot, because him and I were pretty close, of what I remember. And we had friends there that lost a daughter. And I don't know, it just something about it. If you're in it, you remember it. It puts it in your head, and you never forget, no matter how old you are. My family was in trouble. They're my main concern. I wasn't no hero. I had to get them out, or get somebody to get them out.
I could hear people, coming and saws, and, they were coming with chainsaws and sawing wood above my head, and I kept thinking, my word, they're going to cut me. And one time they picked up the wall. They thought they had it loose to pick it up off of me, and then they let it down again. And that was excruciating pain. And that was worse than it was the first time. And then they, finally they got it off of me, and I couldn't stand up, I couldn't walk. And they thought my back was broke. But I told him, I said, can you get Petey? And he said, our son, and he said, yes. And when I looked back, it was really weird because it was like a little box all around me. And I think it was a window that had fallen in around me and had saved me.
When you go through something like that, there's a lot that can tear you apart. And with the family caring as much as it does, it helps. You can pull off of each other to keep yourself going. And that's what done it. I know a few times Mom said, when I was younger, that if it wouldn't have been for at least me being there, it wouldn't have helped her get over my brother. And I think that's what kept them going a lot. It's just for the fact of me.
When they see the grandkids growing up, and you hope they never, ever have to go through anything like that, because it's horrendous. It's something you never, ever forget. something you can't explain to anybody, the crushing feeling of having a whole house fall on you. You can't ever tell anybody that unless they've gone through it. I mean, you just can't explain to anybody. And the feelings, I mean, I know there's other people that lost their family members, you know, and some of them are probably bitter about it. But we aren't bitter. We felt that there was a reason for all of it, and we just went on with it. Went on with our lives.
The signs of what lay ahead that fateful Sunday 30 years ago were first seen by the watchful eyes of Weather Service employees. And as the severity of the storms intensified, so did the urgency to get the word out to as many people as possible. But communications were severely limited by downed telephone lines and blocked roads. Finally, in a desperate move to keep pace with Mother Nature, a decision was made to issue a tornado warning for the entire Michiana area. As far as we know, it's never been done before or since anywhere in the country. But you'll hear from the men who were in the weather office, this was no ordinary day.
Probably around 12 o'clock, things were starting to happen pretty much in Iowa, Illinois. Tornadoes, severe thunderstorms, hail. And I, and of course others around there, were kind of keeping an eye on it. Then about, I can't remember the times, seems to me it was around 5 o'clock. We got a call from Chicago on the radar. They had a hook echo outside Michigan City, Indiana, near a little town called Knox. We put out our first warning based on that hook echo. And I must admit, in those days, hook echoes, you knew what they were. You didn't understand a lot of the meteorology and the science that was going up. You knew it was a warning situation, though. As a result, although we had probably 20-some tornadoes in the next few hours, every tornado had a warning out ahead of it. The first one based on a hook echo. Admittedly, there were some warnings out for one tornado and another one hitting the same area during that warning time. In fact, that was the main problem. There were so many tornadoes and so widespread, communications were disappearing, which by today's standards were quite primitive. And finally, I put out what turned out to be the, the crowning statement, the one they gave us the award on. I put out a blanket warning for all our counties. That had never been done before.
Our office was lauded for what we did, considering the enormity of all these tornadoes that occurred. But we were kind of scared. We were wondering, you know, did we do enough? And we found out we did okay. We had three phones going, and everybody was reporting, and there were different places. And normally, you know, you get a tornado, you can go into a big map and pinpoint the tornado and then get another report and see how it's moving. But they were reporting, getting reports from all over the place. It just couldn't keep track of it after a while. And as a result, that blanket warning was put out.
It was a nice day. That probably contributed to much of the disaster because so many people were out of touch with the mass communications. They were outside playing.
After the first of the tornadoes hit, communication was critical in preventing more death and injuries. Those in the storm's path had to be warned immediately. And for those who still had electricity, television was their communication link. As the designated emergency broadcast system station, WSBT provided information through the night. Anchorman Roland Kelly updated thousands of concerned viewers who were waiting anxiously to find out more about their family and loved ones. Roland remembers a night of chaos, frustration, and fear in his own words.
On the air, I saw many of those pictures the first time, too. We did not have time to edit and to take a look at the film before putting it on the air. So it was just as frightening, and the impact was just as great for me being on the air as it was, I think, for the people looking in.
The first band of the killer tornado slashed across the five-county northern Indiana area shortly before nightfall, as we mentioned earlier. The second cluster swirled out of the sky an hour later and ripped across central Indiana.
I used to do the late news on Sunday. Would usually get into work around 6 o'clock in the evening. But about 4 o'clock, I got a call from Bob Hoyt, who was then the news director, saying, you better get in here fast. We've got tornadoes popping all over the place. Well, I didn't get back home until about 10 o'clock the next morning, then a couple of hours sleep, and then back again to continue the coverage. At last count, as we have it from around the state, 91 persons were killed in the state of Indiana by the twisters which hit the state earlier tonight. It was the most devastating natural disaster I've ever been involved in. I've never seen anything like it. It was a case of a small cadre of people working together for a long time. We knew each other pretty well. We knew what we could do, and it's a great cooperative effort, no question about it. With them was their son, 15-year-old Steve Endrew, who told of his harrowing experience in an interview at the hospital.
Steve, how old are you?
15.
And you were in a car at the time?
Yes.
Who was in the car?
One of the things that disturbed us was the fact that we had tornado warnings on the air during the afternoon. It was, again, it was one of those cases where people just weren't paying attention. And I think a lot of that happens today, too. And you never really know. Maybe a tornado watch, maybe a tornado warning. Nothing may happen. But every once in a while it does. And it's best to be prepared. That's the latest information we have to this time. We hope that you'll tune in again tomorrow morning at 7:30 for the On the Go program, when we'll bring you up-to-date information on the holocaust which struck northern and central Indiana this evening in the form of tornadoes.
It was a day of heroism. But there was one unfortunate reflection of human nature during the crisis. While local radio and television stations broke into programming in the hopes of saving lives, there were hundreds of angry calls complaining about those interruptions. This can now serve as a reminder that the next time you see a weather bulletin, there may be lives at risk. Well, in just a few moments, we'll visit with a man who has a boy witnessed death and destruction at the Midway Trailer Park. And we'll also talk with a woman who was thrown from her home and was saved by a nearby lake.
Coming, and it sounded like a bunch of jet bombers flying over, lots of them, and then there was dirt flying all around us, and it felt like something was drawing the breath right out of my body.
At the Midway Trailer Park in Elkhart County on US 33, out of 120 mobile homes, only 12 were left standing following the Palm Sunday tornadoes. Living in one of those mobile homes was the Lauchs family. 8-year-old Kevin was enjoying the unseasonably warm weather with his friends when Mother Nature took a turn for the worst.
In the morning, actually that mid-morning, I was out playing out back in the back row there with some kids. And, it was sunny and everything. It was a nice day. And then it started getting cloudy and the storm started coming up. And, of course, we never thought anything about storms at that time. You know, I mean, it's just like, oh, well, another storm, you know, big deal. And so my brother came back on his bicycle and told me that I had to come home because they had storms out, you know, and I thought, well, I don't want to come home. I want to stay and play, you know. But finally he got me to come home, you know, so I went inside and I was sitting down watching TV and it was lightning and thundering carrying on. And then my dad was in the bathtub taking his bath, and we never thought about taking a bath when it was lightning out or anything, you know. I mean, it's just something you did, you know, you didn't worry about it. And then they came across TV that this real bad tornado was, you know, what path it was taking and everything. And it was in Wyatt. My dad jumped up out of the bathtub and he said, that's heading this way. And he just put on his bathrobe, and you could just start see the pine trees start laying down. It was coming across the field then. There's just no warning at all. And so he told us to rush underneath the beds, that that'd be the safest spot. He ran over and opened all the doors to the trailer to help equalize the pressure. And I think that's the only thing that saved our trailer at the time. But when it came across, it was the loudest roar I ever heard in my life. It was just unbelievable loud. And it was like a vacuum. You couldn't breathe. There was no air. And I snuck out from behind the bed and looked out the back window, and I could see a trailer going up in the air and turning around. And of course, you know, it only lasted maybe 15 seconds, 15, 20 seconds at the most, and it was done, it was gone. I remember I was underneath the bed and I was shaking, and my mom said, okay, I think it's okay, we can get out now. And we came out here in the kitchen and we sat down, and I remember seeing the second funnel cloud going across over towards the Zook Edition over there. And my mom was telling me, you know, now just, I think we're gonna be all right, it's going the other way. And I said, shh, be quiet, it'll hear us. You know, I don't want it to hear us, you know, I don't want it to come this way. You know, and so I was really scared. And at the time, there was traffic like you wouldn't believe on this road. Of course, 33 was a two-lane road back then. And the ambulances and stuff couldn't even get here because of the traffic pileup already. You know, they'd already gotten here. And my dad had went down to direct traffic and help out where he could. And there was cars lined up out there on 33 when the second tornado came across. And there was old guys that got out of their cars that couldn't hardly walk, that ran across the street and jumped a 4-foot-high barbed wire fence and ran into the woods because they were so afraid, you know. I was playing with a boy, his name was Brian, in the back row. That's what we was doing then before I had to go home. And unfortunately, he never made it out. They found his body underneath two or three trailer frames, and that was one that my dad helped pull out, and he had to quit that. That's when he decided he was gonna go out back on the road and help direct traffic, because he couldn't deal with that, you know, as to deal with kids like that that were dead and all beat up. And you know, I was 8 years old and really didn't quite comprehend everything that was going on. Now my brother Larry, they had to put him in the hospital for over a week because he almost had a nervous breakdown from it, you know, because all his kids, you know, his friends were here and stuff, and they were all gone. Of course, as a kid back then, you know, it was just something you go through, you know. I mean, it was a bad experience, you live through it. But now that I'm older and realize exactly what it is and how bad it can be, I really do thank my lucky stars that I'm still here, because there's a lot of people who lost their lives here.
Another survivor, Diane Claybaugh, was just a young woman back in 1965. Her husband was in the military serving overseas, and she was with her parents in their new home near Hunter's Lake. The three of them had just returned home after a visit with her sister when danger appeared on the horizon.
It was a very humid day. It was very close, warm, exceptionally close for that time of the day or year. And we were going to go into Goshen for a shower for my sister. She was getting married. And so we went there in the afternoon, and then we came home probably about 4 or 5, and it was getting cloudy. Then the wind really started blowing. Eavesdrops were flying off people's homes and trash cans. And then the electricity went out. And of course, at that point, that was probably around 5 o'clock. And so then, just probably about an hour after that, time-wise, I'm not really sure, we just happened to look out the window and we just saw this little tail. And at that time, my father said, it looks like a tornado. We better get down on the floor. So we did, and we covered our faces and our heads because we did have a big glass picture window. And that's about all I remember until I was just kind of swirling around in water. At that point, I called out, not knowing where my folks were. I did see my dad, who had swam up the shore. And then shortly after that, behind me, I heard this noise, and it was my mother, who couldn't swim, and the neighbors had a big purple footstool, and she was hanging on to that. So my dad swam out and saved her then. And then I walked back to the road, and the neighbors came down and took us down to their home, and then he brought my mom, and they eventually then took us to the LaGrange Hospital. We all had injuries, but nothing serious, not like a lot of people had. The house was completely gone. There was just the fireplace standing in the one corner. What had happened was the floorboards had just come up and threw us all into the lake, which we thought, you know, we would remain on the floor and just cover our heads and everything would fly over us, but that wasn't the case. There was just nothing left, a crawl space and a chimney. It was about it. You always hear about people drowning in lake, and in this respect, the lake saved us, because you heard about people that landed in trees and on other land, and you know, there was no hope for them, but with the water, we were really very fortunate. And you also found out that the material items don't really mean that much as long as everybody lives.
Gosh.
I didn't realize.
30 years later.
It comes back.
Yeah, it really does. You kind of hope that it doesn't have to ever happen to anybody else.
Yeah, I hope my children never have to go through it.
The roof of the house landed in Hunter's Lake along with Diane and her family. And up until a few years ago, scuba divers say they were able to clearly see the roof sitting on the bottom of the lake. The Lifesavers. Just ahead, we're going to tell you about two of the men who performed heroic acts that Sunday to help save perfect strangers.
In the basement, did that come flying in after you were down there?
Yes, it came in out, took the house off, and then the car came in down in the basement. We was between the car and the stairway landing.
Many of those who survived now say they probably wouldn't have lived if they didn't find safety in their basement. Houses were ripped apart like cardboard, making underground cellars the only hope for most families. But can you imagine looking up and seeing every one of your possessions gone? And even worse, the structure you once called home now threatens your life? Two men and their families from Dunlap lived through that very experience, and 30 years later, still remember what it was like.
Well, I tell you, that was really something. We had our eyes all closed and was sitting down there on the floor, and you could hear the grass of the glass cracking in the windows and everything. And it's just a deafening roar. And it only lasted possibly 30 seconds or so, and it was past. But it just completely devastated everything. And I had there was a big beam come down and put a pretty good gash on my head, but the rest of us, other than contusions and abrasions, fortunately, there wasn't, you know, too much wrong, except Mrs. Beeler's mother, they found her out on the railroad tracks back there, and she was decapitated. And Mrs. Beeler, they found her out by the railroad tracks, because she had only got partway down the cellar steps. They found her out there, and she was critically injured, but she survived. Well, I stood up and looked out over the edge. Their house was all gone, and I looked out over the edge towards my place, and of course my place was all gone, except my stone fireplace was still standing. This automobile landed upside down in their basement, and you could smell gasoline. It was just pouring out of their gasoline tank. So we got out of the basement in a hurry. We just cleaned up all the basement walls. And our number two son, he kept yelling, it's so hot, so hot. And was sitting on the floor, and their water tank had ruptured, and he was sitting in all this hot water.
I looked out and saw the tornado coming, and Mary asked me, say, what are we going to do? I said, lay on the floor and cover the boys up. And so right then we did. And first thing that happened was the door slammed open, and then the door slammed shut, and you could hear the glass breaking, and it was breaking all around, and the ground was shaking from the tremendous force. There wasn't anything left, no walls or anything. It was completely destroyed. changed my life, probably the fact that we adopted two girls later. I think that was probably a result of, you know, trying to reach out and help someone.
There are, of course, many who survived but did not escape injury. Thousands were rushed to area hospitals, putting a strain on the entire emergency response system, from the rescue workers to the hospital employees. This sort of disaster cannot be prepared for. There had never been anything of this magnitude before or since. But everyone who could lend a hand did, and their efforts prevented the death toll from skyrocketing even higher. Among those heroes, two men in Elkhart County. One worked through the night at the Midway Trailer Park, the other at Goshen Hospital.
We had gotten a call to a house that they thought was burning. It was destroyed, it wasn't burning, but from there we could see the Midway Trailer Park. And it was just total devastation as far as the trailers were just laying all over. Actually, most of the trailers were gone. All you'd see was a frame and the wheels. There were wheels on them. You couldn't see where the streets were. They were just total destruction. People were, they were just covered with mud, some of them. You couldn't even hardly recognize them. Some had been obviously killed when the first firemen arrived. Some were trapped under their trailers. Many of them were cut up with broken bones.
Almost the first persons that I saw there was a woman and her two children that had been brought from the Midway Trailer Court. I didn't recognize them until she called my name, and then I realized that it was somebody that I had seen as a patient and knew very well. But she was so dirty and sandblasted from the tornado that I didn't recognize her at first. From then on, the ambulances, the trucks, the station wagons kept bringing people from the disaster at the trailer court, and it was just a matter of trying to keep up with the flow of patients after that. My particular job that evening was triage, that is, determining who was injured worse, who was less injured, who could walk, and then assign them to different areas in the hospital. One of the important things that happened that night were people who weren't necessarily medically related, but who tried to identify victims and then find out where the rest of their families were. Many families were separated. Some of the family went to Goshen, some were taken to Elkhart, and they didn't know how the rest of their families were doing. And so a lot of that needed to be communicated back and forth. And if you recall, we had telephone communication within Goshen area, but we had no communication with Elkhart or long distance communication. All those telephones were taken out by the storm.
Dr. Troyer tells of one special memory in that time of despair. When Goshen Hospital put out a call to anyone with medical experience to come help, over 50 doctors and nurses from across Michiana showed up. In just a few minutes, the story of two Michiana men whose lives are still impacted by the power of the Palm Sunday tornadoes.
Jansen, you said that you were following the tornado as it came in. Would you explain that, please?
Well, I first heard the call on the radio that it was just getting ready to touch down just north of 6 and 31. As I come out of Lakeville, I spotted it. I shot down Shirley Road. I could see it all the time. You could just see it, just grab a house and just twist them up.
The thousands who took action the night of April 11th, 1965, without question made a difference in the disaster relief efforts. But what isn't as well known are the people who are still taking action today. The tornadoes did more than just destroy lives. Its power also shaped the lives of those who lived through it. In Elkhart County, two men are living examples of the positive effects of the Palm Sunday tornadoes.
That night, our terror was we didn't have a house, because every place we went, we found places of devastation. Now, as it turned out later, we just happened to be crossing the path too many times, but we had no way of knowing it at that moment in time. We had debris in our front yard, some of which was paper from homes that had the names, address of where the people were from, that was up to a quarter mile away at the point in time when we become a national disaster. The professionals cannot possibly handle that by themselves. They require volunteers to help. My role in part of Elkhart County Skywarn is the number one, I work with the National Weather Service to give them an eyes and ears report about what's going on. The second thing is to make sure the citizens of Elkhart County, through the Department of Emergency Management, are able to be informed that we have weather coming in. People are basically good. If given a channel to help, they will. And I think a lot of times we've forgotten that we need to have channels to help people, and we need to have channels to let people help.
When I got involved with Skywarn, from the very beginning, we formed in 1979 in a meeting in a church basement in Dunlap. Well, I'd only been in the hobby a very short time before this. And it suddenly occurred to me, here was the opportunity that you read about in the hobby magazines or the leagues magazine. But here's a chance to take your hobby and apply it to good public service. It's a heck of a resource, and it doesn't cost the public or the government anything. It's there. It's a hobby, and everybody collects their radio skills. And through a planned program, then we have procedures nowadays of how we function. And Elkhart County works hard at trying to provide a service as far as Skywarn.
Tonight, we have been telling you the numbers. More than 250 dead in the Midwest, 81 people here in Michiana. Here now are the names of those we lost 30 years ago today as we remember Michiana's worst disaster.
At that time, and as we were starting to get the injured out and take care of the fatalities, another twister showed up.
There is no way to minimize the tragic impact of the Palm Sunday tornadoes. Hundreds killed, thousands injured, and a countless number of homes destroyed. But from many tragedies come a lesson of sorts, some kind of knowledge gain that wouldn't have been possible if the disaster had never occurred. And from the storms of April 11th, 1965, we have learned an enormous amount of information that we benefit from every day. News 22, Steve Barron examines the silver lining from the Palm Sunday tornado clouds.
Remember Rick Clark? He's the six-year-old boy who escaped from a collapsed house and got help for his family. Today, he's a volunteer firefighter and says going through the tornadoes may be a reason why.
I just wanted to do it to help people. Maybe because there were so many out there that helped us. That might be why.
Weldon Troyer was one of the doctors at Goshen Hospital during the storm. 30 years later, he's still practicing medicine right next to the hospital.
I'm helping to participate in exercises where disaster drills are done, both in the hospital and in the community. I'm glad to see that the community has developed means of early warning.
Weather sirens are now in place over much of the area, and broadcasters are using high-speed automated technologies like News 22 Stormwatch to keep you better informed.
From the News 22 Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Sam Scammon. The National Weather Service has issued tornado warnings for the following counties.
So there are some good things that came out of the tornadoes. A higher sense of urgency, a lifelong commitment to learning, and some new technologies. We can only hope the next time tornadoes threaten the area, people remember the tragic lessons of Palm Sunday 1965 and realize just how dangerous the weather can be. I'm Steve Barron.
Not every step towards progress was an easy one, however. During the Palm Sunday tornadoes, the closest weather radar was in Chicago, too far away for us to know the severity of the storms. The efforts to bring a weather radar home to Michiana was critically important, but the struggle was by far an easy task. The fight for our own radar lasted years, and Bob Warner tells us how the battle was finally won.
He'd get a message in of a wall cloud or cloud formation coming in. He'd pick up a pebble, throw it up, and bang it against the window, and he'd open up the window and he'd give them the message, and they'd put it out and start looking.
Believe it or not, that's how the Weather Service and Civil Defense used to let each other know when someone had spotted a tornado in Michiana. That was before the advent of radar. Using the destruction of the Palm Sunday tornadoes as proof, Don Gurman and local politicians worked to get new technology to Bendix Field.
I wrote two letters to the president. We've got all of our representatives around here, being on the state and national side, and our senators. They've all fought for us.
The former deputy director of the Civil Defense credits former 3rd District Representative John Bradamus with making the radar a reality in 1982 after a 15-year fight. And that's a reality that Gurman says should not be taken for granted.
People take heed. You don't want to go out there and hear and say, well, here it goes. You want to say, well, it's gone. It's not here yet.
For News 22, I'm meteorologist Bob Werner.
It's been 12 to 15 years since the battle over radar was won, but a new fight is now underway. In 65, people felt unprotected from severe weather because of a distant radar system. Today, the same argument is taking place, but now the focus is on a Doppler radar system.
Through a government plan called Modernization, the National Weather Service is attempting to bring its organization into the 21st century. Part of this plan includes a national network of Doppler radars, radars that in theory would blanket the nation with Doppler coverage. These highly sophisticated radar units have higher resolution, are more sensitive, can detect most tornadoes, and have more range than any other weather radar in U.S. history. The plans do not, however, include the installation of one of these units here in Michiana, yet. As it stands now, our area would receive its severe weather warnings from three different Doppler radar sites, Indianapolis, Grand Rapids, and Chicago. The Weather Service office from Chicago would warn into northwest and north-central Indiana, including South Bend and Elkhart. This means that eventually the South Bend Weather Service office and radar at Bendix Field will close. It has already been proven that Doppler radar from Chicago cannot see lake effect snow east of LaPorte. And worries also exist that the radar is too far away to see tornado development over Michiana as well.
Right now, the National Research Council is reviewing a proposal put forth by those of us that are concerned about this issue. If everything falls into place, it is my opinion that a Doppler radar system will be installed here in Michiana in southern Elkhart County before the year 2000, scanning the skies over all of Michiana. Just ahead, what may be the most important part of the program, what you should know when severe weather strikes your area.
You think the children were aware of what was going on?
Not at first. They weren't aware at all. They thought it was a game.
What happened when it finally did hit?
Well, then they broke out in tears and crying, a lot of crying. They couldn't stop.
What about yourself? What emotions did you feel?
Well, it was mostly on the children. I really didn't think much about myself and just trying to keep the children from getting cut.
You may have heard safety weather tips before, but can you separate the myths from the facts? It's crucial to know the exact steps to take when you only have a few moments to decide. Lisa Moser tells you what you absolutely need to know.
It's a twister! It's a twister!
If you're at home when a tornado strikes and you don't have a basement, go to an interior room away from outside walls or windows. If the windows are open, leave them open. If they're closed, leave them closed. It's a myth that opening windows can save the house in the event of a tornado. Air pressure drops outside the house. The pressure inside is equalized as air seeps through cracks. Since tornado winds can be as great as 300 miles per hour, those strong winds can rush in, rip off the roof, and leave the impression that the house exploded. But suppose you're not at home when a tornado hits. You could be at work or out shopping. What do you do?
I would hide.
I would probably get behind something and cover the back of my head so nothing heavy would fall on it and hurt it.
I would look to get down, protected in some way, away from the windows.
What I'm supposed to do is lock up the cases and get everyone to go up to the front of the store by the offices, which is where we take everyone to keep them out of danger, away from the glass or the windows and so forth.
Tim Wishman, the Assets Protection Manager of Target, tells us what would happen if a tornado hits his store.
As far as a tornado warning, the store will then page an announcement stating for everyone in the store to move to the rear of the store, away from the front. Windows and doors.
If you're in your car, a small building, or a mobile home, get out. Seek shelter elsewhere, like a large building or a ditch. For News 22, I'm meteorologist Lisa Moser.
And when there is bad weather, 22 WSBT puts a warning map in the corner of your television screen. Not all of us can recognize our county on a map, so we have a quick and easy solution. Stick this Michiana map on the back of your remote control for a quick reference. They're available at all Martin's supermarket stores. Certainly, prevention can be one of your best defenses against this sort of tragedy. We hope this 30-year look back on the Palm Sunday tornadoes does more than just stir your memory. It is our hope that with a closer look at the devastation Mother Nature can inflict, you will better understand the potential danger when severe weather strikes. They say history repeats itself, and while we may not know when or where, we can sure a tornado outbreak similar to the Palm Sunday tornadoes will happen again. But knowledge is power, and with this knowledge, everyone has the power to save their own life and those of their loved ones. Thank you for spending the last hour with us. I'm Sam Scammon. Good night.